Welcome to my presentation of From Oi to Joy, Jewish musical style in American popular songs, which is also the title of my doctoral dissertation. I want to start with the sound of the shofar, the ram's horn. We all know this symbolic signal of Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. Listening to the blast of the shofar year after year will certainly leave an emotional mental blueprint. But do we consider this Jewish music? And if so, what are the musical characteristics? However, is this Jewish music?
Vayishma Yitro Kohen Midyan Choten Moshe Et kol asher asa Elohim le Moshe ul Yisrael.
I examine Jewish music through the concept of holistic ethnomusicology, in which the emphasis lies on the totality of disparate musical and cultural manifestations. In the concept of holistic ethnomusicology, Chazanut cannot be separated from cantillation, Yiddish folk songs cannot be separated from Chazanut, wedding music cannot be separated from Yiddish folk songs, and Jewish art music is connected with cantillation, Chazanut, Yiddish folk songs, and wedding music. The different manifestations of Jewish music are linked, which involves establishing a broad view of music as an interrelated musical process, yielding a canon of Ashkenazic Jewish music at the end of the 19th century. In this talk, I will take you on a journey through the influence of Jewish music into American popular songs from the first half of the 20th century. Therefore, my main research question is, did this canon of Jewish music from Russia and Eastern Europe influence the music of Jews in America, the New World? I will address several new terms, such as the Jewish musical style, Jew notes, musical code switching, minor moods, happy minor, songscape, and intrinsic Bulgar rhythm. But how can I compare Jewish music to American popular songs? Aren't these two completely different entities? To use a metaphor, can I consider this research as comparing apples, the Ashkenazic Jewish music, to oranges, the American popular songs? Which methodology can I use in this cross-cultural comparative study? For example, ethnomusicologist Alan Lomax used in his cantometrics as many parameters as he could come up with for analyzing one song, a too complicated theory for my research on hundreds of songs. Or I could have used Jack Gottlieb's methodology in his book Funny It Doesn't Sound Jewish, in which he focused on finding one-to-one sources instead of stylistic musical similarities, as I did. However, after looking at methodologies from other academic disciplines, I came up with the musicological equivalent of the periodic table of chemical elements by the Russian chemist and inventor Dmitri Mendeleev. So at first, I looked for all kinds of characteristic musical elements from the canon of Jewish music and placed them into a taxonomy table. Of course, I use sheet music mainly from Edelsohn, Gieselgoff, Kostakovsky, historical literature, and wax cylinder recordings from online digital archives. I divided the table into melody, harmony, rhythm, form, timbre, and language. At a certain moment, I had 30 elements. I've named some elements because then they are easier to remember and to recognize in another context. Since we have limited time, I won't go into much detail, and I will highlight a few of them. The minor mode, the minor major change, the kol nidre motif or the wail, circling the minor second, the hava nagila motif, the augmented and minor second, the oi motif, the rising minor sixth, skeeps or lips, large interval steps, shofar blast, spitzsong or sprechgesang, with harmony, the Gregory Walker, the passamezzo moderno, the lamento bass, descending chord progressions, the Yiddish goodbye, or the secondary dominant, and with rhythm, the room for the patch, or the clap, a hand clap on the weak beat of a measure. Subsequently, I've transformed these elements as compounds in a periodic table of Jewish musical elements. Periodic, because it's possible to add elements such as dynamics and tempo to this table. So now, we make a turn to the new world, the United States of America. Reflecting a more optimistic outlook after the Civil War and the formal abolition of slavery, the major modes prevailed in folk songs, minstrel songs, Stephen Foster songs, Civil War songs, African-American spirituals, Parda songs, Bel Canto songs, Sousa's marches, Ragtime, and Timpanelli songs. The tunes of this period were characterized by small diatonic intervals, simple harmonies, and on-the-beat melodies. What we now call children's songs, such as Old MacDonald Had a Farm, Oh Susanna, and After the Ball, were considered popular songs for adults at the time. Most melodies of these American popular songs were built from a sequence of consecutive notes, whereas Jewish music consisted of various motifs. So this kaleidoscope of musical colors determined the songscape at the turn of the century. I coined and used the term songscape to define a landscape of tunes, whether at home, at work, in bars, saloons, or in the streets. On the first day of January 1892, Ellis Island in New York Harbor opened as an immigration station. Subsequently, fleeing the pogroms in Russia and Eastern Europe, 2 million Jews choose America as their new homeland. There's an old joke that if Jews come to a new place, they will establish two synagogues, one to visit for services and one to never set foot in. And the same applied for the Yiddish theater. The more Jewish immigrants arrived, the more Yiddish theaters they built. Historian Irvin Howe pointed out that, quote, by 1918, New York City had almost 20 Yiddish theaters, and numbers of others were scattered across the main cities of the country, end quote. In the first decades of the 20th century, Jewish immigrants incorporated their songs with ethnic musical stereotypes, the so-called heap songs, from Hebrew, and transformed these tunes into a quintessential Jewish musical style. In doing so, they reflected upon themselves as part of the assimilation and acculturation process into American culture. Of course, these heap songs are great ethnomusicological sources. For example, in the song What Can You Mach This Is America, you hear the minor mode, which is alternated with major right after the chorus and then again to minor. Listen to What Can You Mach This Is America.
Kein Amerika zu kommen, hab ich kein Mietisport, hab gedenkt darauf zu werden, in verlosen sich aber. Hab ihr Hart wie schöne Päev, wie jeder Primärin. Zum Sofern statt an Bord, hab ich dem Päev solches nicht. Wenn ihr mich fragen, steigt, wie kann das sein? Der Terrence, der Fien ist liebe Freunde mein. Was? Can you make it in America? Do you land up in the sea? What can you make it in America? A feel it there is a good thing for the meeting going. As from payers, the statement by chain of litigious for the trunk zig the payers, all a made like gold. What can you make it in America? We American, what?
In the jazz age, the first two decennia of the 20th century, songwriters used the minor mode not only to express a feeling of sadness, but also to evoke other moods. After analyzing hundreds of songs, I coined the contextual purpose of five different moods of minor modes in American popular songs at that time. The five minor moods are sad minor, nostalgic or melancholy minor, oriental minor, ethnic songs about a harem, a vamp, Egypt, response to the Egypt craze, exotic minor, about the jungle and American Indians, and Happy Minor to indicate a joyous up-tempo tune with nothing to worry lyrics. The minor is derived from Russian and East European Jewish folk songs. The happy minor is often alternated with major to refer to the mood of a mainstream American song, such as Stephen Foster's old songs, and is a form of musical code switching. Also, some happy minor songs ended suddenly in the major key, the so-called Picardy Third, which was common practice in the Renaissance and Baroque period and was used in the 1920s and 1930s to adjust a song to mainstream American context. For example, the Oriental minor song Palestina, or Lena from Palestina, was full of stereotypical Jewish musical elements and musical code switching. After a successful instrumental version by the original Dixieland Jazz Band in 1920, the popular Jewish singer and actor Eddie Cantor had a huge hit with the song all over the country in February 1921. Having reached number two on the charts, Palestina was one of the first Jewish musical style songs to become popular outside the Jewish community. The song tells the story of Lena, a girl who travels from the Bronx in New York City to Palestina. However, the melody of the chorus was adopted from the Romanian Jewish wedding tune Noch a Bizal, just a little bit. Remarkably, all versions of this song have clear references to pre-existing Jewish tunes in the instrumental interlude directly after the first chorus. In the Eddie Cantor version, the 8-bar instrumental part is adopted from the melody of Chazen Kalem Mazel Tov. The song Palestina is characterized by a simple tune, but is essentially built of modulation, large interval steps to Ukrainian Dorian mode and chromaticism. Okay.
They say that Lena is the queen of Palestina, just because they like her concertina. She plays it day and night, she plays with all her might, she never gets it right, but how they love it, one more of it. I heard her play once or twice. Oh, murder, still it was nice. She was fat, but she got Lena pushing on her concertina down old Palestine away. They like her concertina. Each movement of her rhythm.
I consider the 1920s as a musical crossroad for Jewish Americans. In this jazz age, songwriters musically assimilate to jazz music and the accompanying companion blue notes of African Americans. On the other hand, they were continuously confronted with allegations in the Dearborn Independent, which was the weekly magazine and mouthpiece of automobile manufacturer, violinist, and music lover Henry Ford. The headline of the August 6, 1921 issue of the magazine was "Jewish Jazz, Modern Music, Becomes Our National Music." Probably due to the influence of Henry Ford and his Dearborn Independent, Jews didn't use stereotypical Jewish musical elements in a large part of the 1920s in mainstream American popular songs. Another road to take was the decline of New York's Yiddish theater in the second half of the 1920s, which had served as a parallel music industry to the Broadway theaters with their mainstream popular songs. So now we have three roads to take: Henry Ford's old songs, Yiddish theater songs, and jazz music. In the fourth road, Jews combined these three directions into a new one, which was introduced in the film The Jazz Singer. Announced as the first talkie, the film The Jazz Singer premiered on Thursday, October 1927 at Warner Brothers Theater in Manhattan. According to the Hebrew calendar, this first day was exactly the day of Yom Kippur, the most important Jewish holiday. Because most New York Jews were in the synagogue during the day, the opening of the film certainly took place after sunset that evening. In this way, fiction became reality within the plot of the film, which dealt with the discrepancy between religious life and a decadent one in the world of entertainment. Imagine Jews who left the synagogue after the last shofar blast of Yom Kippur, hurrying to be on time to buy a movie ticket. Especially at that moment, people wanted to be present at the premiere of this first talking picture. One of the dramatic highlights in the film was Al Jolson performing the song Blue Skies on the piano at home while his mother was listening. However, Jolson's enthusiastic performance came to a sudden end when his father, the cantor, appeared, became enraged and sent his son away. Blue skies became dark, stormy clouds. Irving Berlin's song Blue Skies was a milestone of the Jewish musical style and the first mainstream popular happy minor song. In 1927, it was highly unusual to compose a song with a mid or fast tempo chorus in the minor key, without references to sadness or the Orient. Berlin used the fast tempo minor mode and minor major alternations, such as the first sentence ends in G, the parallel major. The very first two notes of the song title resemble shofar blast, just as the rising fifth interval of the first shofar blast, Tekiah. Berlin's musical signature, the first notes of Hatikva, appears in the bridge, only this time in the major key. Never saw the sun shining so bright as a walking musical stairway to the skies without the minor third. However, the second bar alternates to C minor with a minor second, just as Hatikva. Blue Skies has large interval steps, the so-called leaps, such as descending major sixth step and descending minor chord progressions, lamento bass in the chorus. Rhythmically, there is room for the patch, the clap, on the first beat of the second bar in the last beat of every bar of the bridge. And this bridge, never saw the sun shining so bright, can be played tapping a Bulgar rhythm. Jewish songwriters often use the bridge of a song to incorporate an intrinsic Bulgar rhythm. Listen to Blue Skies.
Not much blue skies do I see. Bluebirds singing a song. Not much bluebirds all day long. Never saw the sun shining so bright. Never saw things going so right. Notice in the days hopping and by, when you're in love, my how they fly. Blue days, all of them gone. Nothing but blue skies from now on.
As blue notes refer to major, the new term, Jew notes, make use of the minor mode. The term first appeared in an interview with saxophonist Lee Konitz when he remembered that he, quote, had a problem playing blue notes, end quote. Konitz told the interviewer, quote, I hope that they, the blue notes, fit into a musical phrase and make some sense, but they're not part of my heritage. I call them Jew notes when St. Gads play them or when I do. Oi, doi, 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 oi, doi, 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 holy Moses, end quote. Jazz saxophonist St. Gads and Lee Konitz were both Jews whose parents had come from Russia and Eastern Europe to America. The Jew notes consist of the minor second interval, the augmented second interval, the minor third interval, the raised fourth, the rising minor sixth, and the octave leap. Blue notes and Jew notes featured the music of two minorities, the African-American and the Jewish-American immigrants, who were freed from slavery or escaped from pogroms and met each other in jazz. The nostalgic minor song My Yiddish Mama is another milestone in the influence of Jewish music on American popular songs. The Jewish-American singer Sophie Tucker made My Yiddish Mama an all-time hit song in 1928 with English lyrics and the parlando part in Yiddish, with a full Yiddish version on the B-side. After the great stock market crash of 1929, the Great Depression coincided with the sad minor mode songs Brother Can You Spare a Dime by Jay Gorney and How Deep is the Ocean by Irvin Berlin at the time. Jay Gorney based the chorus of the song on a tune he had learned as a child in Russia. And surprisingly, in 1932, Brother Can You Spare a Dime became the American anthem of the Great Depression. Also in 1932, the song It Don't Mean a Thing became a hit record and therefore paved the way for the swing era. Besides, It Don't Mean a Thing grounded the Jewish musical style on American soil. Publisher, manager, composer, singer, and bandleader Irvin Mills, who was born in Odessa, Russia, probably wrote the minor mode melody line and corresponding lyrics of the song title of Duke Ellington's hit song. Subsequently, Duke Ellington probably came up with the straightforward melody of the B section. It makes no difference if it's sweet or hot. Just give that rhythm everything you got. Ellington's reputation as a melody collector is widely known. In the early 1930s, composer George Gershwin based his all-time hit number Summertime on Oi, Het Sie Ein, Mein Lieber Menschen. Gershwin probably used the melody of this old world beggar song for an opera version of the play The Dybbuk. However, he could not obtain the rights for the script and transformed the melody into Summertime of his African-American folk opera Porgy and Bess. Although the notes are certainly not identical to the arrangement and the context differs, the sweet lullaby feel of these two songs is very much alike. Coincidentally, around the same time, the instrumental version of the beggar song Oi, Het Sich Ein, Mein Lieber Menschen also appeared in different arrangement and tempi in the film Jiddle Mid and Fiddle. Listen to Oi, Het Sich Ein, Mein Lieber Menschen.
Herz sich ein, meine lieben Menschen. Hört sich ein, etwas ich will euch fragen da. Ah, wie kommt es, ah, so weit ich in a kleinen Fiedel. Hört sich ein, nicht alle liebe Menschen. Hört sich ein, nicht was ich will euch fragen noch einmal. Ah, wie kommt es, so stark erweht ich in so kleinen.
In 1938, two Jewish brothers, Jack and Dave Kapp, who worked in the entertainment industry, saw the talent, quality, and business opportunities of the free singing Andrews sisters. These men gathered a Jewish team around the sisters who were not Jewish. The Andrews sisters' Jewish supporting team created a simple and effective marketing plan to achieve success. In the mid-1930s, the United States hosted millions of immigrants from different countries. Although America offered freedom and a better life with new possibilities, these immigrants and their descendants longed for the music of the country they had left behind. For them, this music meant an imaginary link to their past. How do you address this main target group and sell a lot of records and sheet music at the same time? By adapting melodies from original tunes in Italian, French, German, Spanish, Cuban, and Jewish musical styles, adding English lyrics and turning the music into a swing arrangement. After its release in November 1937, the song by me, Bist to Schön, catapulted the Jewish musical style in American popular songs. It sold 100,000 copies in its initial release, and by the end of January 1938, had sold 250,000 copies worldwide. No jingle bells this year, a Yiddish Lidl, they swing it, was the headline in Billboard magazine of December 25, 1937. Following the article, that Christmas holiday season, people sang By Me Bist du Schön instead of jingle bells. By Me Bist du Schön certainly belongs to the soundtrack of the Jewish people and would serve as the ultimate reverence for the Jewish musical style in American popular songs. By Me Bist du Schön is a simple three-chord minor key song in an up tempo, nothing more and nothing less. Yet this happy minor song contained elements from the periodic table of Jewish musical elements. The minor mode, of course, with an emphasis on the minor third without alternating to major, the rising minor sixth step of the first notes by mir of the chorus, unusual in American popular song at the time. There's room for the imaginary clap or patch after do to me, schön, explain and grant. There's an intrinsic Bulgar rhythm which can be easily tapped at bella, bella, even way wunderbar, and only helps me tell you how grand you are. And of course, a descending octave leap from the last note of the verse to the first upbeat note of the chorus. The song title is Yiddish. Listen to By Mir Bist du Schön by Ella Fitzgerald.
Of all the boys I've known, and I've known some, until I first met you I was lonesome. And when you came in sight, dear, my heart grew light, and this old world seemed new to me. You're really swell, I have to admit you deserve expressions that really fit you. And so I racked my brain hoping to explain all the things that you do to me. By mere Bist du Schön, please let me explain. By mere Bist du Schön means that you're grand. By mere Bist du Schön, again I'll explain. It means you're the fairest in the land. I could say bella, bella, even say wunderbar. Each language only helps me tell you how grand you are. I've tried to explain by mere Bist du Schön. So kiss me and say you understand.
Following the success of By Mir Bist du Schön, the Jewish musical style was also adopted by African-American performers and songwriters, such as Cab Calloway, Billie Holiday, and Slim and Slam. Listen to Slim and Slam. Another example of the Jewish musical style is the song Who's Yehudi, sang by Cab Calloway, that could be about being Jewish or refers to violinist Yehudi Menuhin.
There's a man on on every tongue. Grandpa, grandma, and the young. What's the fuss is all about? They're just trying to find out. Who's your hootie? Who's your hootie? Someone please lend me a hand. Solve this mystery if you can. If he's mice or if he's man. Who's your hootie? Who's your hootie? Who's your hootie? One dark night, about 3:30, I saw an owl up in a tree. He looked down and he yelled at me. Who's your hootie? G-Man Hoover's getting moody. Got his men on double duty, trying to find out who's your hootie.
Who's your hootie?
Who's your hootie? The little man who wasn't there said he heard him on the air. No one seems to know from where, but who's your hootie?
While researching this thesis, I contacted songwriter Jack Lawrence to ask about the influence of Jewish music on American popular songs. Jack Lawrence confirmed the existence of a Jewish musical style and pointed at the work of the non-Jewish Cole Porter. Lawrence had known Porter because the director of Chapel Publishers commissioned him to rewrite the lyrics of Porter's My Heart Belongs to Daddy, which at the time were labeled as highly suggestive. Through regular visits, the young Jack Lawrence was present during the telephone conversations between Porter and Berlin, where they were always teaching each other. Almost 70 years later, Lawrence wrote to me about these calls and the influence of Jewish music in several emails. Part of this correspondence was published in Sheet Music magazine under the title A Little Touch of Yiddish. Berlin and Porter, quote, shared a daily telephone friendship, admired and complimented each other on every new score, and traded a standing joke. Berlin would phone and say, "Well, Cole, looks like you've just written another great Yiddish melody," end quote. My Heart Belongs to Daddy contains several Jewish musical elements. On the opening line, while tearing off a game of golf, you can easily tap a Bulgar rhythm, while singing the melody, which consists of a Kol Nidre motif by the minor second move, has room for the clap, the patch on a further quarter note. The Hasidic Nigun da-da-da in the chorus on the notes B, E-sharp G resembles the Ahava Rabba mode, with an augmented second and minor second step as in Hava Nagila. Remarkably, to return to a mainstream American popular song, Porter wrote the last sentence of the chorus in the major mode, clearly musical code switching. Listen to My Heart Belongs to Daddy by Bia Wayne.
While tearing off a game of golf, I may make a play for the caddy, but when I do, I don't follow through, 'cause my heart belongs to Daddy. If I invite a boy some night to dine on my fine Finn and Hattie, I just adore his asking for more, but my heart belongs to Daddy. Yes, my heart belongs to Daddy, so I simply couldn't be bad. Yes, my heart belongs to Daddy, da 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 da. So I want to warn you, laddie, though I know you're perfectly swell, that my heart belongs to Daddy, 'cause my daddy, he treats me so well.
To illustrate that you don't have to be Jewish to sing in this Jewish musical style, here's a video recording of the Peter Sisters live in France, 1959.
Daddy, I do, daddy, I do, daddy, I do, daddy. the cheer, especially when the bridegroom and the bride appear. The folks all dance with glee, they're as happy as can be. Soon they'll be in addition to their family.
Kusen kala mazel tov. Kusen kala mazel tov.
They all think it's mazel tov.
They don't know the go is rough, it's rough.
Kusen kala mazel tov.
So far, we learned about the taxonomy of Ashkenazic Jewish music, heard about old songs in the major mode in the 19th century, five different minor modes, the happy minor, Jew notes versus blue notes, songs in the Jewish musical style, which were adapted from Yiddish theater and folk songs, and new songs in this Jewish musical style. Too close. Just as Jews are considered the people of the book, my research has demonstrated that Jews are also the people of songs. Especially in the 1920s and 1930s, Jewish composers offered a never-ending stream of songs, and the Jewish musical style certainly deserves a place in the history of American popular music. Although the great composers of the first half of the 20th century are no longer with us, their songs have survived. Therefore, I end this presentation with the words of Irving Berlin: the song has ended, but the melody lingers on. Thank you for your time and attention, and I would now be interested to hear your questions, thoughts, and comments.